Hello everyone, I'm Zhao Li. I'm going to introduce our work, SPADA, Accelerating Sparse Matrix Multiplication with Adaptive Data Flow. Sparse matrix multiplication, or sparse gene, is widely used from graph analytics, molecular dynamics, to machine learning. However, these matrices have drastically varied size and density. For example, the densities of sparse neural networks can be minus 1 power of 10, while the density of graph analytics can be minus 6 power of 10. Besides, the non-zero distributions of these matrices are also very diverse. So this together creates diverse sparse patterns across different workloads. These sparse patterns result in sparse genes being executed with different intersection efficiency, partial sum generation, and data reuse. On the other hand, sparse gene has different execution data flows. For example, inner product, outer product, and row-based. In inner product data flow, a row of matrix A and a column of matrix B are dot-producted to get a scatter element in the output. Then, in outer product data flow, a column of A and a row of B are cross-producted to get a partial sum matrix. Last, in row-based data flow, a scatter of A is broadcasted and multiplied with a row of B to produce a partial sum row. These data flows have different performances in terms of data reuse, index intersection, and partial sum granularity. For example, the outer product data flow has excellent input reuse, but its output reuse is poor. Besides, its partial sum granularity is large. Therefore, there is high performance improvement potential if we could adopt different data flow schemes with respect to different sparse patterns. Unfortunately, none of previous works explores such possibility. To realize such potential, we propose SPADA, which performs adaptive hardware execution according to sparse patterns. First, we propose an adaptive window-based data flow, which is easy to be adjusted and covers wide trade-off space. Second, for the hardware, we propose a mode-reconfigurable accelerator, which is efficient to execute the data flow and can swiftly switch among different modes. Last, we propose a profile-guided window shape adaptation algorithm, which can effectively detect sparse patterns in a lightweight way. So first, we introduce our window-based adaptive data flow. Let us start from the row-based data flow. As we have introduced, in row-based data flow, sparse gene is decomposed as scalars from A multiplied by rows of B. And the window is slid along the k dimension first. Our window-based data flow is to scale the scalar of A into a window, so that multiple scalar vector multiplications are performed using parallel hardware units. And we still slide the window in the k dimension first. When finishing an iteration of k, the window shape can be adjusted with respect to a fixed window size. For example, here we adjust the window from 2x2 to 1x4. The whole sparse stream computation forms many task trees, with the scalar vector multiplications as red nodes and reductions as yellow nodes. Each task tree represents a computation for a single row in A matrix. For example, the computation for the first row corresponds to the first task tree. Similarly, the second row's computation corresponds to the second task tree. We then divide those task trees into intra and inter-window tasks and place them onto heterogeneous units, which improves the multiplier utilization and will be discussed later. So we actually adjust the data flow by changing the window shape. When reducing the height and increasing the width, we are approaching the row-based data flow. The partial sum granularity is reduced and the catch pressure is alleviated. However, this leads to less mesh indices being found in a window. And this indicates that the reduce of input B decreases while the reduce of output C increases. Besides, the ratio of intra and inter-window tasks is also adjusted. On the contrary, by increasing the height, we actually approximate the outer product data flow, which produces more partial sum and mesh indices and causes the reduce of input and output move conversely. Since they have different data use patterns and task allocations, we can trade off between them to find the best fit. To support the window shape data flow, we propose the mode reconfigurable accelerator. Our accelerator is composed of MP, AP, scheduler, and global cache. MP unit performs the intra-window task with multiple scalar vector multiplication executed in parallel, which we will elaborate later. AP performs inter-window tasks, which further merges partial sums and is composed of a comparator tree, an adder, and an accumulation register. The scheduler is designed to arrange tasks, track partial sums, and adjust window shapes. Finally, the global cache is set to cache B rows and partial sums for on-chip data reuse. We now dive into the design of the most important unit, MPE. It consists of multiple computation lanes, which perform scalar vector multiplications. Then it consists of a bitonic network and a flexible reduction tree, which performs adaptable partial sum merges. To map a window, the window size is set to match the number of lanes in an MP. Then each pair of scalar vector multiplication will be mapped to a lane. In this example, the window shape is 2x2, so they are from two separate task trees, and we will configure MP to compute them into two separate groups. This is supported by the modified bitonic network, which can output separately sorted products, and a flexible reduction tree, which can be split into subtrees to perform independent reductions. This hardware reconfiguration is performed in runtime to support adaptive execution. For each lens computation, we first load the A scalar to the multiplier register. Then the B fetcher will fetch a B row and then pass the B elements to a sort array, which helps balance the index distributions among neighbor lanes and avoid skew. And then the B elements will be multiplied by the A scalars. To ensure the order of the merged partial sum of each group, we first pass the products into PQ, which collaboratively maintains the order in a cycle. Then each cycle's products are further sorted by the bitonic network, and finally merged by the reduction tree. Now, we introduce our profile-guided window shape adaptation algorithm. To adapt to sparse patterns, we need to first detect sparse patterns and then adjust window shapes. First, we like to detect the sparse patterns. However, it's hard to track sparse patterns as it requires us to traverse all the non-zero indices, which is impossible. Instead, we propose to detect the changes of sparse patterns. As shown in the right figure, we show the variations of index overlaps from two matrices. Index overlaps represent the number of matched indices between current row and previous rows, which can partially represent sparse patterns. We could see that there exists obvious changes between pieces of sparse patterns. Through observation, we notice that these changes are also reflected in the variation of row lengths. In the figures, we could see that the changes in index overlaps have strong correlation with row length variations. Therefore, we propose to indicate sparse pattern changes by row length variations. Since row lengths can be easily inferred from the CSR format, the detection is lightweight. Then, to adjust the window shapes, we partition A rows into bands by changes in row lengths. For a large band, we profile all window shapes at the head and select the best kernel for the rest. And for a small band, we contiguously adjust the window shape in a cost-descent way. In evaluation, we evaluate SPADA on matrices from three sparse and compressed DNN layers. We compare with three SOTA accelerators, Sigma, Spark, and Gamma. Each uses a different static sparse gene data flow. The evaluated SPADA accelerator uses two 8-lane MPEs, 16 APEs, with a 1.5 megabyte global cache and an HBM attached. The area of SPADA is 6.3 square millimeters, with 4.8 square millimeters occupied by the global cache. And the area cost is similar to that of Gamma. This figure shows the performances of the three baseline accelerators and SPADA. The yellow, green, and orange bars represent the performances of Sigma, Spark, and Gamma. From the figure, we could see that the three accelerators with static data flows have varied performances across workloads. For example, in KKT Power and Poisson 3DA, Gamma, which uses a row-based data flow, performs the best. While in Carry and ResNet FC, the outer product-based Spark has the best performance. Although performs badly in most cases, In cases like ResNet Layer 4 Conf3, the inner product data flow achieves the best performance. On the contrary, the performance of SPADA represented by the blue bars are steady across workloads, which is able to match or outperform the baselines, and achieves on average more than 1.4 times speedup. You then evaluate the effectiveness of the dynamic adaptation algorithm. In this figure, we compare static window shapes and SPADA dynamic adaptation algorithm. To create static window shapes, we control the window size to be 8 and vary the height. The light to dark blue bars show the performances of windows with height 1, 2, 4, and 8. As we expected, the optimal static window shape for each matrix varies. For example, Red Sky and Carry prefer taller windows, while the CA Condomat and NXFC2 prefers wider window shapes. In cases like ML Neuron and ResNet FC, the performance even varies non-monotonically. This again justifies our motivation that different sparse patterns need different data flows. As indicated by the green bar, our adaptive window achieves optimal or near optimal performance, which proves the effectiveness of our algorithm. To sum up, in this work, we identify the impact of sparse patterns on sparse gene performance. We propose SPADA, a hardware-software co-design, which includes a window-based adaptive window flow, and a mode-reconfigurable accelerator, and a profile-guided window shape adaptation algorithm. In evaluation, it achieves on average 1.4 times speedup compared to SOTA accelerators. Thank you for your listening.